But since we are talking about economics, the paradigm which we want to establish is a market economy, but it should be compassionate, not greedy, Rahman. So economics based on the natural laws. That's the paradigm. Why? So here arises a question. If we answer this question, we get there to establish a paradigm. Despite tremendous scientific and engineering advances, we fly with 600 people. We go to the other interstellar spaces, correct or not? Because of science. We go deep into, we have learning technology. And one, this is a beautiful example here under this link, which shows that what they call biomimicry. Biomimicry is to mimic the nature to get benefit for the technological development, scientific development. Science is based on biomimicry. Looking at fish, man started a ship. Looking at bird, man started flying. And looking at mosquito, man started nanotechnology. It is very interesting to notice that the mosquito which inserts the needle, actually we think it is one needle, but the scientists have found that these are 7 needles, 8 needles, different functions. Only one of the needles is to suck the blood, which is enzyme which is helpful by the mosquito. That's the basis of nanotechnology. So why science has done that much progress? Because science has learned from nature. And why the economics have those stresses of destruction? Because we have just gone against nature. Against the class. So if we correct this, we go in accordance with fitra. What is the fitra of us? Inna lillahi wa inna lillahi rajiun. We come from here. What will happen? What happens here? Then we go back here. That's the fitra here of our own lives. We go against this fitra. We think that this is one life here, that there's nothing to return. Our own example, human behavior example. So we go in with fitra. That's the here I put here nature and science, they work together, economics and nature. That nature doesn't waste. Economics is based on waste. Capitalistic economics is based on waste. So we have to correct this conflict here. This is the paradigm. And so this lessons that economics can learn from nature. Nature and economics. Nature doesn't waste, and we should have an economics which is based on zero waste idea. What are the examples? I give you the example of our own life, which is actually circular. We come from here, from him, and we turn to him. Correct or not? That's circular. And look at water cycle. What happens to water cycle? There is fixed amount of water. There are evaporation, and the same water goes up and down, and ups and down, and ups and down. There's no waste of water. Same case with oxygen cycle. Same amount of oxygen is there. And the carbon cycle, marine food cycle, all of this, the natural earth. Nothing is wasted in these natural cycles. So can we economists also learn and establish an economic system where we can at least minimize, and sometimes we claim that we can reach zero waste. That's the paradigm. Okay? So that paradigm becomes a business model. You extract resources, the design of the produce should be such that it is not designed to be wasted quickly, basically. It should be designed to be long life. Basically, this is business process strategy, nothing more than that. And then this concept of use and reuse, and then indeed there would be after that something which we call as waste. This should be biodegradable. That means it should be treated and should be made healthy for earth and merged back to us. So here are the principles of the circular economy. Circular production processes with zero waste. The production processes have to be, from the very beginning, driven by the idea of zero waste. After sale, service, and repair. I don't know, in Istanbul there used to be a lot of watchmakers, watch repair shops. One of them was myself and my friend in 1978. We repaired most of these big clocks actually. This is not even information. Nowadays, that is gone. But what? So basically that's part of the philosophy. After sale, service and repair, end of life, reconnection. Some businesses have already started to take back the material instead of dumping it in the street, so that they will reprocess it and produce the same material instead of cutting more trees. Reuse and recycle, rely on green energy. How much of the solar energy is wasted? Design of products, long life, non-toxic, and CO2 emission. So these are the principles here. There are a lot of advantages of it. Reduce cost, reduce resource dependency, eliminate waste, eliminate negative environment impact. And then waste reduction opportunities and intermediate steps. I think I want to share this. You can share it with your students. For the time reason, these points, they can, the PhD and master's students can look at them to see what are the business different models of circular economy where waste can be minimized. So here is the multi-dimensional development perspective. This is Makassar. Of course, many of you have studied Makassar. And this is, I am from Qatar, coming from Qatar. This is a Qatar national vision. I don't know, do you have a Turkish national vision of the government? These are the SDGs. These are the SDGs. I want to clarify with you one point. Many people criticize us that we are talking about SDGs. The SDG people are doing this and therefore we should do this. These Makassar were given in the 8th Hijra century. Not because of SDGs. This framework was given by Achatibi, Al-Ghazali, and other great scholars. I don't have to explain the Makassar. I am presuming that they are knowing. So what I'm saying is that this is what we should consider as a framework for multinational development. Multi-dimensional development. It's not one dimension, it's multi-dimensional. And you can see therefore the SDGs are also multi-dimensional, and the Qatar National Vision is also multi-dimensional. And if you have to have a multi-dimensional approach to development, it cannot be linear. It has to be like this. It cannot be linear. Linear is only driven by wealth, material. When you put all this in perspective, then it cannot be linear, and that's basically what I mean by a compassionate paradigm. So what's going on now is that we as Islamic finance are actually working here. in this linear pranayama. The only difference is that we say we are doing halal business. That's the only thing. We have to buy a car, which is buying it from Rabaha is halal. That's what we are doing. Basically, we are located here. And actually, our right position is in a circular, in a multi-dimension framework. We will transform it from here to here. Linear business paradigm to circular business paradigm. Basically, that's the central message of the paradigm shift. Which, if that is the case, then the Sharia governance, many of you may be doing a Sharia governance thesis or something like that, then it has also to change, because now it's only addressing to make it halal and put it here, but then there are other concerns for which the Sharia governance has to change. And if you have to change the Sharia governance, then the current situation is like this. The reform situation will be like this. Halal business paradigm plus ethical screening plus genuineness of contract designs, internalizing the institutions of compassion, zakat, aqaf, charities, interest laws. The Sharia people, they should not pay any attention in the current Sharia governance framework to make this as a source of strength of the Muslim society. They only are concerned with Islamic banks. So this responsibility will increase tremendously for them. So if we do that, then there are a lot of opportunities. Actually, there are a lot of opportunities. The first opportunity is that we have to know compassion, rahma is something which is external to the financial contracts. There's a financial contract, and rahma is extracted from it as charity or sadaqah or zakah and distributed separately. This is what it is. But we have to internalize the rahma into the financial contract. How will we do that? Now, for example, mudaraba musharaka, mudaraba, for example, When I say that mudaraba is based on a compassionate feature, people say, no, it's a commercial. It's a commercial, but both parties are sharing the risk. Nobody is aggravating the rights of any other party. So therefore, it's compassionate in that sense. But of course, mudaraba is not the only thing. What we can do to internalize compassion is that the central bank can ask banks to disclose to us, in your financial contract, you have brought that contract, show me how does it meet the maqasid or multi-dimensional relevant features of the maqasid. Put it in the contract. Show me that this is what my contract is promoting the maqasid. Show me in the contract, otherwise I'm not going to give you finance. Show me what type of waste your business is generating. Put it in the contract. How come the waste disclosure is not part of the contract? Show me how your business is not contributing to CO2 emission. Show me in the paper. Show me what type of green energy you are using. Put that in there. This can be part of the contract. The design of a financial contract, if it makes this disclosure, then we become inclusive of the environment, of the society, and we become more compassionate. Then we have the idea of innovative products. Yesterday there was a presentation on BLM. This is one of the people are, of course, the stakeholders to address it, but an example that we have to have innovative products. And I will mention one innovative product later on. But here's one example. And some student told me that he's doing a PhD on LC, letter of credit, with here. For example, last week I saw a paper which says green letter of credit. What does it mean, green letter of credit? You want to import a car? Right now, the letter of credit has nothing to do with the emission of the car. But if you want to make the emission of the car as a disclosure factor, then the LC has to also ask for the disclosure that you want to import a car, show us how this car is not creating, releasing gases which are beyond the standards. So, green LC, for example, is one of the environmental which I saw. Role of regulators. Now here, I should have put here, there is a very important research theme which is climate change as a financial risk. Climate change leads to tornadoes, floods, disasters,